Disney cartoons were worldwide favorites, but Walt Disney wanted to take entertainment one step further. One of the movie makers who helped realize Disney's dream, John Hench.
And I think it was his intense desire to involve people. And in a film, of course, you have a certain way of vicariously associating yourself with the story and with the actors, particularly. But he wanted to give them something more.
Landscaper Bill Evans moved mountains to create Disney's oasis in the Southern California desert.
Here we are in the middle of a desert, right? Man has changed all that, but it was a desert the way Mother Nature designed it. We get an average rainfall of 12 to 14 inches, and that's a desert. Walt was apt to say, hey, guys, I need a jungle, you know? Or I need a Missouri River Shore for Hannibal, Missouri, for Tom Sawyer. Do it.
Some of the earliest visions of Disneyland were in sketches made by Herb Ryman.
When Walt had this idea, and whoever he called in, it was instantaneous. You were supposed to be instantly useful and instantly productive and kind of instant genius.
These instant geniuses and hundreds like them turned flights of imagination into flights of reality. The Disneyland designers changed entertainment forever, as you will see in the Disney Family Album.
You to share with us our latest and greatest dream. That's it, right here. Disneyland.
Before Disneyland, most amusement parks were unplanned, unpaved, unsafe traps for unwitting tourists. Walt's opinion of such places was summed up in a scene from Pinocchio.
Pinocchio! Pinocchio!
It was his first-hand experience in the seedy playlands that sparked his idea for something new and improved.
Well, it came about when my daughters were very young, and Saturday was always Daddy's day with the two daughters. So we'd start out and try to go someplace with, you know, different things, and I'd take them to the merry-go-round, and I took them different places, and as I'd sit there while they rode the merry-go-round, did all these things, sit on a bench, you know, eating peanuts, I felt that there should be something built, some kind of an amusement enterprise built where that the parents and the children could have fun together.
Disney's first notion was a little park across the street from his Burbank studio.
And I saw Walt over there, and he was stepping off something, and he had a paper in his hand. So I thought, well, he's going to put that park over there. We'd heard the rumors about a park, but I think he really thought he could get it all in there. But when you knew Walt, you knew that the idea wouldn't stay that small.
Herb Ryman was signed on to draw the first visual conception of Disneyland.
The telephone rang, and it was Walt. And he said, hi, Herbie. He said, what are you doing? And I said, well, I'm working on my circus paintings. And he said, well, could you come over and see me? And I said, where are you? And he said, well, I'm at the studio. And I said, are you working on Saturday? And he said, yes. He said, I can work on Saturday or Sunday or anything I want. This is my studio. And of course it was. So I was curious why Walt wanted to see me. And he said, Herbie, he said, I'm going to do an amusement park. I said, well, now, what do you want to talk to me about? And he said, well, Herbie, he said, my brother Roy has got to go to New York on Monday. He's got to fly to New York. We need $17 million to start this project. Roy's got to take this stuff back and show them what this is going to look like. And so I got excited, and I said, well, gee, I said, I'd like to see it, too. And he said, you're going to do it.
For the next 48 hours, Herb and Walt slaved over the first design of Disneyland. Their hard work paid off. Ryman's drawings sold the bankers. Disney sought advice from veteran amusement park operators.
And they were sympathetic to Walt, and they gave him really good advice. They said, Walt, forget it. You know, if I did that, I wouldn't be open 6 months. But Walt, you know, he came out of those meetings, and he was just as cheerful as before.
So Walt called on his own staff to design the park. They were not your ordinary architects. They were movie makers. John Hench, for instance, helped design such classics as Cinderella and Fantasia.
I was still on pictures, and then in between pictures, I'd work on Disneyland until one day Walt said, well, I think you're going to stay on Disneyland. And he says, you're going to like it, and I did. It's very much like a motion picture. I think it's very parallel to motion pictures. The fact that you have a long shot, you see something in a longer view, you come in from the medium shot, and you walk up and touch something, you're into a close-up.
Herb Ryman, too, was a movie sketch artist who specialized in exotic settings.
Since 1932, I had worked at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. I was the only artist in the art department, and I did the story development for The Tale of Two Cities, Anna Karenina, The Good Earth. I was not a stranger to doing quick sketches.
For the first time in their careers, the designers had to do more than simply fool the movie camera.
We were getting into practical things, so we'd hired some engineers that we didn't have for a picture. But really, the face of the thing that faces the public, was something we were quite familiar with.
The scenery at Disneyland is half real, half movie set.
We reduced the scale because the miniaturization of the buildings lends another dimension to fantasy. And so there's nothing on the second floors of the buildings because they're too small. Main Street represented the nostalgia of Americana. And of course, since Walt was a boy in Missouri and Chicago, to him, the small town in this Midwest was Americana.
Main Street, of course, is unique in a way. And thank God it's not quite as unique as it used to be, because I think many of the malls across America reflects what people found here. They discovered that shopping could be an experience. And a pleasant one. And they discover that walking in a place like Main Street has something else to say besides just going from one end of a street to another.
Straight ahead lies the heartline of America, an old-fashioned Main Street. At this time, Little Main Street was still the most important spot in the nation, combining the color of frontier days with the oncoming excitement of the new 20th century. Now, at the foot of Main Street, about where you're sitting, is the plaza. The plaza, or the hub, is the heart of Disneyland.
You know, he said, when I was in Europe, when I've been studying this thing, he said, one of the great problems about amusement parks, any kind of a park, is that people, they get exhausted walking. Now, he said, I want to have these radiating spokes from the hub so that people that are tired or sick or old, or they can say, well, you kids run on ahead. We'll meet you here in 45 minutes. And there again was the secret of Walt's amazing concept of entertainment. He knew that people had to be comfortable.
Construction of Disneyland began in August 1954. The park had to open in 11 months. to catch the summer business that would ease the studio's suffocating debt. The designing of the grounds themselves was in the hands of landscaper Bill Evans. Bill and his brother Jack had landscaped Walt Disney's backyard with its own scale model railway. But landscaping 180 acres of barren land was no snap. Bill's first challenge was finding enough trees to dress the set.
The freeways, which were penetrating the suburbs around the Los Angeles area, made possible the salvage of a lot of trees that we could not otherwise have found. And we literally snatched them from the jaws of the bulldozer. We'd get there the day before they were to be demolished, box them out, haul them down to Disneyland. I could show you tree after tree after tree. You know, this was Santa Monica Freeway, that was the Pomona Freeway.
Part of Evan's job, to shield Disneyland from the outside world.
We have shut out the high-rise buildings and the freeway interchange and the power transmission poles. You don't see any of that. When you come into the park, you see what Walt wanted to create here.
Even the shrubbery was to be part of the show.
There are a number of differences between this and the topiary of legend, which it goes back 3,000 years, you know. It's an ancient art. Well, it took about 15 years to get that into a recognizable shape. That wouldn't do for Walt, so. Yes, as if we could do it, we could speed up the process a little bit. We told him we thought we could give him something that was acceptable in a couple of years, so. To begin with, this is an olive tree, and an olive tree in a rather unconventional shape. But it's the same olive tree which produces the olive oil for your table. And were it not for all the shearing that this gets regularly, there'd be olives on this one too. But here we're looking at the 4 feet of this rhino. Now, each one of those is a separate olive tree, you see. Put 4 feet in the ground in a big box, lead them up, join them together, bend and tie and shear until we get this. This is something quite different. That's a Eugenia. And the trunk of the Eugenia goes down through here, down there, and down into the ground with that 4 foot. But the horn is made out of a totally different plant than this. These are all Disney inspired, and what we're looking at, the originals were taken from Fantasia, the waltzing hippos and the crocodiles.
Disney's Jungle Cruise is Bill Evans' landscaping masterpiece.
What we endeavored to do was to create what the armchair traveler might envision as a jungle experience. You see, we picked out material from Brazil and material from Africa and material from India and Asia and Malaysia and pushed it together. It's all quite compatible in the sense that it all has that lush, that vigorous growth, you know, really strong growth. And over here is a fan palm that comes from China. And here, the trunks that we see carry a head that's 30 feet up in the air. These are Phoenix reclinata, which are native to a wide expanse of coastline in Africa. What we have attempted to do in planting this jungle is to make it look as though we had nothing to do with it. We were working on a pretty tight budget, so much so that I recall telling Walt, maybe it was a month before opening, that we'd run out of funds. We needed more plants to finish the berm, you know? And he said, hey, you've got all those jaw-breaking names for all those Latin names. Go out and put a bunch of Latin names on those weeds.
July 17th, 1955, opening day had arrived. Walt Disney would refer to it later as Black Sunday. Rides broke down, food ran out, as 33,000 people stormed the gates. A live television broadcast gives a taste of that opening day chaos.
Let me read these few words of dedication. A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievements. I thought I got a signal.
You're going to come back here in a minute. Right now, Bob Cummings is at the, where is he? He's at the Snow White ride. Bob.
Well, folks, as you can see, I'd like to stay here at the Mardi Gras forever, but there's a Disneyland train leaving for the Western Station right away, and we don't want to miss that. It's taking us to more an exciting land, so take it away on the train, Ronnie Regan.
And this is Frontierland. Inside this stockade, Walt Disney has created a frontier village that could have been carved out of the wilderness 100 years ago by the pioneers themselves.
Everyone was there, including Davy Crockett and me.
Oh, yeah. I got myself into a fix. I was picking whittling sticks. The snow was frozen on the ground. Pack of hungry wolves came round.
In its first 7 weeks, the park attracted 1 million guests. The public's response was a victory for the Disneyland designers.
One marvelous thing about being a designer, you're human too, so all you do is look within yourself. You've got a lot in common with everybody else.
The park even succeeded in ways the designers hadn't anticipated.
It's a very subtle thing. There's a sense of order here that I think comes through to most people. It's quite different from the conditions outside in a regular city street.
Well, of course, it's a total escape. Going from land to land, it's almost like being in another country. There's so much electricity here. You look around, you have a steamboat, you have a pirate boat, you have bands, you have parades, you have these fabulous characters come to life that are over 6 feet tall that are walking around. There's so many tactile experiences. You can go up and touch them. Just the beauty, the shops, the food. There are so many things to experience here that you just don't have outside of Disneyland.
What you do have outside is a sharp contrast to Disneyland's design. Walt Disney resented any intrusion into his kingdom.
I remember one time when we had a chicken restaurant over the side here. And one time one of the workmen drove his car up there, you know. Walt took him out and explained to him, what was this car doing in a turn of a century wilderness? He was actually reminding people, you know, that, and this was a direct contradiction to what we were trying to say.
We should be designing our real world like this. And I think it's rather ironic and paradoxical that we aren't. And yes, it's always frustrating for a person like myself, who's a designer, and this is my charge in life to, you know, create beautiful things for people to live in. And it's a joy for me to come to Disneyland and realize a lesson about how the world could be.
Disneyland's appeal knows no boundaries, but one eager would-be visitor never quite made it.
Khrushchev was a guest of the government. So, I mean, we were ready to receive Khrushchev. But it so happened that the security problem here in Los Angeles, because actually Disneyland is in another county, you see, and our chief of police, we can't blame him, he had quite a chore there to carry out. We had different shots, places where we'd take pictures with Khrushchev, and I had one that was my favorite, where we'd lined up in front of my 8 submarines, you see, and I thought, well, it'd be nice. I've been pointing to Mr. Khrushchev and saying, well, now, Mr. Khrushchev, here's my Disneyland submarine fleet. It's the eighth largest submarine fleet in the world.
One vital element of Disneyland's design, the idea that it would always be changing.
Now, when we add a new element to this system, of course, we have to consider very carefully what the facility is and what it will do. What it will do to round out a guest day. It's got to be a new experience, but it's got to fit in harmony with the others that are here.
New Orleans Square was added after the park's opening. Herb Ryman did the designing.
We made many, many trips to New Orleans in order to get inspiration. This particular courtyard was built and is still there just very much as it is in this drawing. And of course, these are the sisters, which are the ubiquitous part of the scene of New Orleans. I always think if I can put something in that really belongs there, people will be deceived into thinking I knew what I was doing. And then another thing about this, it's very interesting. Walt would never let us indicate any sign of aging. he said, no, I don't want it to look old. I don't want it to look old. And I said, well, New Orleans looks old. It's been there for hundreds of years. He said, I want this to look clean, and the paint is fresh, just like the day it was built.
The designer's home for bloodthirsty buccaneers is the centerpiece of New Orleans Square.
Even though they know it well, there's so many things that people haven't seen. It's redundant in its details. I think that's another thing. We put more and more into it. But I suppose it's an old favorite. It's like a good musical, like Pirates of Penzance, maybe. It has everything in it, music and a little thrill.
Walt Disney's pledge that Disneyland would never be completed now rests with a new generation of designers, like Tony Baxter.
I started with Disneyland back when I first, in my first year of college, and I was employed out there as an ice cream scooper. And it wasn't that I wanted to scoop ice cream, but I really wanted to work at Disneyland.
Tony is one of the principal designers of Big Thunder Mountain Railroad.
When we sit down, we don't go through the catalog and say we're going to do a runaway train. We felt it's an incomplete story if you don't have some sense to this. What's making it go? It's got to have an engine. So we have this little train, it's a runaway, and the engine pulls out on its own. And we get lost in a flurry of bats down in this cavern and find ourselves moving up. But again, in a regular roller coaster, this would be just a period of precipice before the eventual downfall. But in Big Thunder, it's a story on its own. Disneyland is around 80 developed acres. In addition to that are these 30 acres up here, 35, that have nothing in them. We have the New Orleans Square and Bear Country area, and there's a lot of property out behind that. And we're thinking about unifying that so that we have maybe a Dixieland and strengthening that with maybe we have a great property both in music and characters called Song of the South. And everyone remembers the Zippity-Doo-Dah and Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Fox. And we might find ourselves back in the swamps of Dixieland, plummeting down into the old briar patch or the laughing place to the music of Zippity-Doo-Dah and those characters. Discovery Bay is kind of a once-only place in time. It's a Victorian place that occurred at the turn of the century. It's the kind of place that Jules Verne or H.G. Wells might have inhabited. So you'll actually be able to, for instance, board the Nautilus and have a very elegant meal down below the water while you're being serenaded on the pipe organ and looking out at all the scenic wonders of the ocean floor from those overhead windows. This is just one of the adventures that might go into here. There's, like I said, a flight on an aerial suspended monorail system that looks like a dirigible and a time machine. So that's one of our key excitements for the future.
The Disneyland designers brought the movies to life. Audiences became part of the show. It was an idea that revolutionized entertainment.
We do try to use the material that's in film because people know it and recognize it. It helps a great deal to have something they already know. It's something, of course, that we know that they've already loved.
Thank you. of happy memories, especially for the people who designed the place.
Well, mostly memories of Walt and memories of a number of the other designers that aren't here anymore, because it's been quite a while. And of course, the pride you have in being part of something like this, and the fact that it didn't just stop here. It just kept on going.
The guy said, I'll work on this thing as long as it's interesting and exciting. And I said, when it ceases to be interesting, I'll go back to my work. And Walt said, and I remember very well, he said, well, Herbie, he said, I'll try to make it interesting. And of course he did.